the sky, coming in the winter, and a Chinese teacher. And our lead speaker tonight is Professor Jorick Vink from our observatory in Planetarium, and he's been talking about first science with the James Webb telescope, so we're really looking forward to that. Okay, just a wee quick update on Artemis. I'm sure you've all been following it. We're now at day 14 of the 25-day mission, and they're doing some deep space testing at the moment. Artemis was launched on the 16th of November, so that's almost 50 years since the last Apollo flight, which is Apollo 17, launched on the 8th of December 1972. This Monday, the last Monday passed, Orion reached its maximum distance from Earth, which was further than any other spacecraft that was designed to carry people was. And you can see in this image, the spacecraft actually has three flight test dummies in it. So these guys have been pretty far off, around about 270,000 miles away from the Earth, which is quite a distance. At the moment, or tomorrow anyway, it'll be doing what's called this distant retrograde orbit departure, and that means it'll be leaving its orbits, its current orbits around the Moon. As far as we know, it has worked almost flawlessly. They lost contact for a couple of days, I think, or a couple of hours, but it's all been sorted out again. And they're now looking forward to splashdown on December 11th, somewhere in the Pacific Ocean. And you'll be aware that this is the dress rehearsal for the next moon flight, Artemis 2, which should happen in another 2 years. Seems disappointing, we have to wait another 2 years for the next one, but still, it could only be 3 years before we get a manned landing, so we're looking forward to that. Anyway, without any further to do, we'll call on Paul here, and we'll do our spy routine.
I agree, yeah. Takes a little time, this one. Good evening, everybody. I hope you can all hear me up the back there. I'm going to talk about a few things in the night sky, mostly solar system. I'm focusing on this one. And where I am, just looking at the sun. The sun is fairly inactive at the moment. There are a few sunspot groups on it, 31, 49, 47, 51, 52. And there's been some activity from those spots. But they're not dramatic at the minute. There has only been one day this year where the sun has been spotless, and that was back in June. And that's a big change from last year, where there were 84 spotless days, so 64 spotless days last year. Of course, going back to 2019, there were 281 spotless days, which was something of a record at the time. That was actually the deepest solar minimum for about 100 years. So the sun is lighting up nicely. Now, there is, at the moment, a coronal hole on the sun there, and there it is. That is emitting solar winds towards us, which could be arriving any time from tonight onwards. So keep an eye, if you do get clear skies in the north, keep looking out for the aurora. It did happen on Monday. It turned out, on Monday, I was actually in another meeting, and my phone was beeped, and I had to stay in the other meeting until the very end, and by which time they're all gone. I was actually even by the sea at Ballygally at the time. But however, Paul Wharton down in Craig Adam was on the wall, and he got that lovely shot across the Craig Adam Lakes on Monday evening. So it is happening, it is coming further south, and the auroras are visible. But that would probably have been seen as a whitish fog. Cameras do 20 seconds and eyes don't, it's that simple really. Modern cameras, very, very good, will capture colour and so on in the aurora, but it have to be quite bright aurora for you to see that with your eye. Hopefully, as the cycle 25 carries on, that will improve when we do get naked eye visible auroras. Okay, so let's have a little look at the sky now then. What do you mean about how good that goes? Quite dark. Shall I turn the lights down a little bit further? Now, off. Doesn't go much further off than that. Okay, so we're looking at the sky, and you don't get pointed on this, do you? Looking here at the moon, and closest to the moon is Jupiter. And what date did I put on that? That was the 7:30 in the evening. This coming Friday, the 2nd of December, which just happens to be one of our designated next things. I'm in control here. I think I'm in control here. So that's where we are this coming Friday. It's where we're observing lights. So you'll be able to see that. You can see, the reason I sort of highlighted this is that from the left to the right of that picture, you can see all of the outer planets at the moment. So let's have a look at those more individually. I think it's only going to let me do that. Can you actually see that? I mean, that's just, I think some of the other sides are a bit brighter. So for this, for example, is the moon. Oh, yeah. Right, so here we're looking at the moon. And now, this is a very specific time and date. 5th of December, next, is that Monday? Yes, Monday, yeah. And it's just after sunset, just a little while after sunset. This is actually 1657, and the point here is that you just see the upper limb. Uranus will disappear behind the moon. Now, I'll tell you now, this is not a naked eye observation by any stretch of the imagination. Not least because Uranus, okay, there are some people who say they can see Uranus naked eye. Magnitude 5.7, that's perfectly possible. However, not next to a minus 12 full moon, almost full moon. You won't see that. You need a telescope to see Uranus disappear there, and it will disappear for quite a few minutes. It's not quite a grazing occultation, it's a bit more than that. It does disappear. You'll see that that's 1657. It's about the last appearance of Uranus there, and comes out a bit further over the top there, and that is at 5:20. So about 20 minutes or so of Uranus disappearing there. Telescopic only, you will not see that, not even in binoculars. You need a good lot of magnification to see Uranus in there, with that difference in brightness. So that's that one. While you're looking at the moon, this is actually for the 2nd of December, so that is our observing session, and that is the waxing gibbous moon, and it's a very good, this is going to help me. Very visible there to the lower left is Clavius. All astronomers have favourite things, and my favourite moon crater is Clavius, and it's quite a good thing just to sort of use for outreach purposes. So Clavius is approximately the same size as Morgan Island. Let's say if you took your car to the moon, it would take you about 2 hours to drive across Clavius from one side to the other, about 120 miles across. Looks pretty great there, so that's what we're looking out for if you're looking at the moon on Friday. Now Saturn is sinking in the west. Now it's not so good, but you can still see Saturn. If you have a telescope at least 30 or 40 times magnification, you'll be able to see the rings. Unfortunately, binoculars don't quite have enough magnification to see Saturn's rings, but you may see that it is not round. But 30 times, 40 times magnification, telescope to see Saturn's rings. Once you've seen that, I'm afraid you'll be hooked. You'll have to talk to Andy about something bigger. That's how it works. And there's a family of moons there. Titan's quite easy to see. Others you sort of tend to have a telescope on it and crank the gain up a lot to see it. So there's Saturn. Now you can see Neptune. I'll just give you an idea of where it is in the sky. That's where the red cross is there. So it's not very far away from Jupiter, and it is just beneath the head of Pisces the fish, the five star sort of hexagon that shows, or pentagon rather, more accurately. But it's the head of the fish. Just below there is Neptune, and looking a bit closer, that's what you get. Magnitude 7.8. It's a little blue blob in your telescope, and that, I'm afraid, without using the Hubble or some such, is about what you get to see in Neptune. Fairly sparsely populated part of the sky down in Aquarius. Jupiter, of course, is fantastic. Now, that's again, that's the view from Friday evening, and just so happens that all four Galilean moons will be on the same side of Jupiter that time. If you, you need to wait a bit a little longer to actually see the Great Red Spot come around. But it does every 10 hours or so. We'll see that. And looking absolutely fantastic at the moment. In fact, it completely changes the view of that whole part of the sky. It's Mars. You can see Aldebaran, Taurus and Bull, the Seven Sisters just above that. Rachel shows and Orion coming up on the horizon, that's 7:30 in the evening. And you can see that it's put Mars. It's right there in that, what would normally be that fairly dark bit of sky in between Gemini and Orion. And it's looking quite fantastic now. It's almost minus 2 magnitude now. So it's actually, I think it's today or tomorrow or thereabouts, it's actually its closest to the Earth. It's at opposition on the 8th of December. The two dates aren't necessarily exactly the same because Mars has a very eccentric orbit. So, now this is a bit more of I wonder if this is going to play on this computer. Let's give it a go. Yeah, this is Mars. Now, Mars is currently in retrograde motion. I'll try and illustrate that here. This is going back to October, where Mars was moving around the sky in its normal direction, and has now gone into reverse. It's heading back towards Taurus and the Seven Sisters. And then what happens as we get to January, around the middle of January, it will do a handbrake turn again and start heading its normal direction back off towards Gemini. And that is Mars retrograde motion. It doesn't really change direction at all, of course, it's just the relative motions of Earth and Mars make it look like that. But it's quite a good effect to observe over a number of nights. So that's Mars. The other thing happening with Mars, now how rare is this? On the 8th of December we have a full moon, we have Mars in opposition, and the two are perfectly lined up. So that Mars will be occulted by the moon. Let me just start the video, you know, this happens, it actually disappears for approximately an hour. Pretty close to exactly an hour in fact, because it's a useful bit of knowledge, just a little tip, that the diameter of the moon rather moves through its own diameter once in an hour. So it'll come out the other side shortly, an hour afterwards. So that's over 6 o'clock in the evening now. And morning, 6 o'clock in the morning. I'm sorry about that. I thought you thought that was going to be really easy to see. No, it's not. It starts at 4:50 to 5:50 in the morning, quite high the rest. So that's that. My hero, Mr. Cumber. So I have just one more thing to mention, and that is the Gemini meteor shower. And this year, I'm afraid, it's not terribly favourable, but see, you might get to see it if you're writing meteors, because the moon comes up on the 13th at 9:30 and 10:30 on the 14th. And really, you're looking for the best meteors sometime around about after midnight. Because that's the way the Earth and the meteor shower line up best. So that really is it. Just for saying, well, keep looking up and stay safe. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks very much, Gail. Apologies for struggling with the technology.
We're gathered at a bit of a rush this afternoon. Just one thing about the occultation of Mars. You may think it's not worth getting up at 4:40 in the morning to see that. But I can tell you that there won't be another occultation of Mars by the moon until 2039, and that will be in twilight, so it will not be quite so easy to see. But anyway, I'm certainly going to make an effort to see it. Set two alarms just to be safe. Right, the teaser. In honour of tonight's talk, there's two parts to it. We all know about the Hubble Space Telescope and, of course, now the James Webb Space Telescope. So, first question, if the Hubble Space Telescope was to have a look, well, metaphorically have a look, to image the James Webb Space Telescope, how much would it see? And I'd like to venture a guess on that. I can see the mathematicians, their great cogs churning in their brain. Anybody want to guess? Well, I'll tell you the first part. It will, of course, be able to image it because it reduced beta and light spec. But even the Hubble Space Telescope would not be able to resolve the James Webb Space Telescope because it's a million miles away. It's 4.5 times further away than the Moon is. So even the JWST with all its power couldn't show any detail on it. Now, if the positions were reversed, if the James Webb Space Telescope was where the Hubble is, and if the Hubble was out at the Lagrange 2 point where the James Webb is, and remembering that the Hubble only has a radius of 2.4 meter diameter, whereas the James Webb Space Telescope has a diameter of 6.5 meter diameter, if Webb was to look out where Hubble would be, could it show anything on the image the James Webb Space Telescope?
By heart. Part
of
my
calculation? Nope. Very good, you get the prize. Yes, James Webb's telescope only images in the infrared, and the Hubble wouldn't be shining in the infrared. So in theory, it could just about see more than one pixel, but because it's infrared, it wouldn't be a pixel. So that's how you have a Mars bar or a Milky Way. Mars bar. But,
what's your question? This is down to tonight's main speaker. It's a very great pleasure to welcome Professor Jorick Vink from Armagh Observatory in Ontario. And Jorick is going to tell us all about. Listen, IT is going to kill us. He's going to tell us all about the science of the James Webb Space Telescope. Jorick.
So yes, the James Webb Space Telescope. Now, everything about the James Webb Space Telescope has been much. Hopefully, most of it will still have to be discovered. It's only just flown. But so I put the title First Light with the James Webb Space Telescope, and that means we can use the James Webb Space Telescope to look at the first light. So it's a bit of a pun on words. If you have a cosmic timeline and you had a big bang in the very start, after a couple of million years, 100 million years, that's the moment when the light switched on. That's when the first stars formed, so the first galaxies, and then it took billions of years to reach the light in the galaxies like those of our own. And reversely, when we are in a galaxy like our own Milky Way, then we could look back in time to the very beginning, and that is what James Webb is doing, looking back in time to the very, very first stars in galaxies. So that's first light with the James Webb Space Telescope. But of course, we also. Is that a bit of an echo?
I think it is like that, Jorick, unfortunately.
Right. Let's have a look. Hopefully this little video works.
Maybe not.
That doesn't really matter. So you may have thought to see the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope. So, sorry about that. But it was last Christmas that we had the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope. And I can't stand that song. Over the next couple of weeks, I'm going to hear it a lot. At least it brings a smile to my face, because then I can think of that this guy went up. Now, it was already mentioned 6.5 meters in diameter. A huge telescope, and it's really amazing what we have already seen over the last couple of months, really. So we went up on Christmas Day 2021,
took about a month to deploy, and 3 months to align the mirrors, and then from the summer onwards in this year, it's already been taking data. You must have already seen lots of the images, and obviously, I'm not going to come here to show all of them. I just picked a few that I like and that I think have an interesting scientific story to tell, even though it's still very early days. So it is we call sitting in L2, that means Lagrangian point 2. So Hubble is going around the Earth, but this is sitting like very far out. So we have the Sun, the Earth, and then sitting outside, and it's basically potentially, there's no potential that it should be sitting there, but it of course wobbles a little bit around, but it's more or less static, and just sitting there, and the mission should last 10 years. So it's a 6.5 meter mirror, so it is quite a bit bigger than the Hubble Space Telescope, but it's 2.5 meters or something like that. So a much larger collecting area, higher resolution, spatial resolution than Hubble. The big thing is that it has this focus on the infrared. It only observes in the infrared. Sometimes you hear people say it's 100 times more efficient than the Hubble. That's only at specific wavelengths. That's true. It can be, in some cases, 100 times more efficient than Hubble. But Hubble has lots of other advantages. You can observe in the optical and in the ultraviolet. So I would like to see them as complementary to each other. So the James Webb has cameras to do imaging, and it has spectrographs, both in the near and in the mid-infrared. And I keep talking about these wavelength ranges, and I thought, let me, just for some of you to remind you what this means. So here you have wavelengths. You can have very long wavelengths, like in the radio regime, and then you can have very short wavelengths, in the gamma rays. So we normally look in the visible, Hubble mostly looks in the visible, sort of in the middle of the spectrum, and as I said, Hubble also looks at shorter wavelengths, the ultraviolet, and then you go to X-rays and gamma rays. Whereas if you go on the other side of the visible, you get the infrared, so you have near infrared, there's one camera, and one spectrograph, near spec, that is a near infrared camera, and then you have a spectrograph, and you have MIRI, which is in the mid infrared. And then you have long wavelengths. And frequency does the exact opposite. So if something has a long wavelength, like radio waves, they have a very low frequency, whereas gamma rays and X-rays, very short wavelengths, very brief, they have lots of, the frequencies are very high, like 10 to the 20 hertz. And that basically also shows you what you can look at. Now, a star like a sun is 6,000 degrees. So if you look at this picture here, it should be mostly sort of yellowish light. Now that's what the sun is like. If you look at blue stars, very hot, the most massive stars, they're hotter than this. They go, and therefore they are very efficient in the ultraviolet. And if you want to look at where stars form, that is very much a process happening at much lower temperatures, and therefore you need to go to longer wavelengths. So you don't look at an infrared regime. So that is the reason why things like star formation, where you can peer through dust, will all take place in the infrared. And that is where, that's one of the big things that James Webb can do, that Hubble cannot do, to really look through the dust, even in nearby star forming regions, to really look at where the planets are forming, and all these kind of things. So that's one big advantage. And now, you may have seen the comparisons. This is Carina. This is a massive star-forming region. And you can see there's a lot of detail. I mean, Hubble was already amazing, but the James Webb, the detail that you can see is quite stunning, I think. Yes, it's clear that the James Webb is going to do fantastic things for science, as well as for public outreach. So I'd like to talk about three things. Stars, galaxies, and not so much galaxies like our own Milky Way, but galaxies in the early universe, which have the first stars in them, and then the second part, also to do with galaxies in the distant universe, and there's maybe a little twist at the end. So, stars. I like stars. I work on stars. And this is a normal star, the Sun. So stars spend about, stars like the Sun spend about 10 billion years burning hydrogen into helium. So in the core of the star, the nuclear processes are taking place. A star also has a core and an envelope. And in the core is where it's very hot, very dense, and this is where hydrogen is burning into helium. It's the main process. For 90% of the life, this is where all the action happens. And then, at the end of that, when the core starts to contract, the envelope starts to expand, and that is when the star becomes red. Now, for the Sun, that takes another 5 billion years or so. So currently, the Sun is halfway its life. We know this actually pretty accurately from age dating, for meteorites and so on. That is actually happens. You can actually put a date on it, 4 digits, it's 4.56, and I don't even know the number, but it is an actual number. The forward evolution is a bit more uncertain because it depends on the physics, both in the course of these stars and in the envelope of these stars. So when I say less certain, I mean, we know it's going to happen. We know the star will eventually expand. It's just a question of what is the uncertainty on that number. And I think it's important to talk about uncertainties when we talk about science. And so it will maybe take 5 plus or minus, we say, 1 billion years. So I can't guarantee it's 5 billion years, 4 or 6. There's not going to be 1 or 8. So we know it's about 5 billion years. And then indeed the star will become a red giant. So that means it's now no longer as hydrogen in the core, but helium. And the helium will burn into carbon. 3 heliums make 1 carbon, and another helium give oxygen. And that means you get a carbon-oxygen core. And then around that, you still have the burning of the helium, and then you have hydrogen left in the shell. So you really get an onion-shaped layer in a star, and you can really start to build up all these elements in a star. And some of these elements were not present in the Big Bang. In the Big Bang, there was only hydrogen and helium, but all the other elements, like carbon, oxygen, etc., they all forged in the cores of stars, and some of the elements in later in supernovae and so on. But this is what happens in stars. And then, towards the end, when you even get rid of final bits of the life, the last percent of the life, the star becomes more and more luminous, and it starts to expel the outer layers. And then it starts to contract, and it goes very hot. And then the material that is lost in space is suddenly lit up by ionizing radiation, ultraviolet radiation, ionizing the thing, and then you get what is called a planetary nebula. And we have seen the most amazing pictures of Hubble over the years, like Cat's Eye Nebula is very famous, and other ones. But as you can see, with James Webb Space Telescope, I don't think it disappoints. It looks very, very, very amazing. And you can learn a lot that you couldn't learn from Hubble, because now you get much more detail about the gas and the dust in these outer layers, and really learn about the evolution of stars, low mass stars like our Sun will go through, and also more massive stars. So at the end of that material disperses and the star cools, and it becomes really a white dwarf. So a white dwarf is a collapsed star. And the Sun is basically the mass is still that, more or less the mass of the Sun, but it's now no longer the size of the Sun, but it's the size of the Earth. So this is suddenly very compact. Now, that is what we call the life cycle of a star, the evolution of a star, like our Sun, from its normal main sequence life via the red giant phase, planetary nebula phase, into this compact white dwarf. Alternatively, the same nebula, and when I say nebula, this is the star-forming regions I was talking about earlier, like the Carina region that we saw in that earlier plot. This is where you have gas and dust, and under certain circumstances, that material comes close together, and closer, and under the gravity, you get a runaway effect, stars form, and it depends on certain conditions why you get a low-mass star like the Sun, or you get a high-mass star. So when I say a high mass star, is a star more massive than 8 times the mass of the Sun, is blue, and that star, say 8, 10, 20 solar masses, these also become retrogens. they're much more luminous than the red giants, much more luminous, and much higher mass loss rates. And when these cores collapse, you get actually an iron core. And when the iron no longer produces any energy out of iron, and then it throws off, basically the core collapses under its own gravity, and it throws off the outer layers. That's when you get a supernova. So here we have a second possibility for a lot of the material that was forged in the cores of stars to get lost in space. So for low mass stars, that happens via these red giants and planetary nebulae. But for massive stars, that happens continuously in winds around blue stars, red stars, and then a supernova. Now, it used to be thought that both neutron stars and black holes come from objects that were supernovae. We no longer think that's the case. So this plot is actually outdated. I think the neutron stars, if you have a neutron star, then basically it means you had a supernova. If you have a black hole, you probably didn't have a supernova. I'll come to that in a second. But what is a neutron star? It's also a compact object. It's the mass is still that of like sun, or maybe 8 times the mass of the sun, the mass of the sun. But it collapses, and now the size is not the size of the Earth, but it's about 10 miles. So it's from here to Lisbon. That's pretty compact. And now if you have a more massive star, more massive than 25 solar masses, and it can be up to a couple of 100 solar masses, you actually have to have a third one, a very massive star. It totally skips to that supergiant phase, because this star remains compact. It loses all its mass very rapidly, the stellar winds. And it never makes a supernova, but it just directly collapses in a black hole. And this phase, they go from a massive star to the black hole. In between, you have something called a Wolf-Rayet star. I'll come back to that in a moment. But basically, that's going back to the black hole. The black hole also has the mass of 20 solar masses or so. But what is now, this is not only 10 miles across, but this is now infinitely small. It is so dense that even light cannot escape. So that is what is called singularity, and that is why you have a black hole. So it's really interesting that if you get a black hole, you no longer get any emission. So if you have been making new materials in the course of your star, in the case of planetary nebula or supernova or Wolf-Rayet star, you lose the material, and that means that the nebula that is formed is enriched. So that every time that this circle happens, that this material from the planetary nebula and from the supernova is ending up back here in the nebula. And every time you go around, you build up the metallicity in the universe. Every time, again and again and again. But if you ended up in a black hole, it's gone. So material that ends up in a black hole will have a very different chemical signature than stuff that comes out in winds and supernovae. Now this whole process is kind of understood somewhat in our own lucky way. But for stars in the early universe, we have no clue about any of this. And there are very good reasons why this could be totally different. And I'll come to that. So let me talk a bit about these massive blue stars. So this is not a real image because these stars are far away, but this is just fake news. This is the sun, basically, with blue light. But they might look like that. They might also be magnetic and stuff, and there might be spots, and there might be phenomena that we just don't see yet. But what we do know is that these stars are very bright. They are like up to 100 times the mass of the sun, up to 10 million times brighter. So you can see about very large distances. When I say very large distances, I don't mean the early universe. I mean just nearby galaxies. But good enough to start testing certain distance ladders. But that's another topic for another day. But what is so special is that they are very hot. So they emit the light in the ultraviolet. The physics is totally different. In a normal star like the sun, it's all to do with convection flow processes in the star, just like boiling a pot of water. But for these massive stars, it is this ultraviolet radiation that pushes all the material out of the radiation pressure, and they get these huge outflows. And that is what we see in particular towards the end of their lives when they are Wolf-Rayet stars. This is a Hubble image of a Wolf-Rayet star, 124. And you can really see the nebula that is blown. So this is the Wolf-Rayet star. It's blown all the material outwards. And these stars lose 90% of their initial mass in these outflows. So if you start with 100 solar masses, you only end up with 10. So your black hole is not 100, but it's 10. In the early universe, the time is totally different. If you start over with 100, you might end up with something close to 100. But that's still uncertain. Now, this is Hubble. And with ground-based imaging, and with also Hubble and so on, people have been imaging these kind of gray stars, and some of them have not a nebula, but they have shells. And if you have a certain outflow of a star, you're going to have puffs. Yeah? It's not a static process. It doesn't always maintain these mass loss at the same rate, but there are times when you have more of it and less of it, and then these shells start to interact with each other, and then you get nice shells around stars. You may have seen pictures of that before. And the most I've ever seen is two. One star with maybe two rings around it. And then when I saw the next James Webb Space Telescope picture a couple of weeks ago, it blew my mind. I don't know if you've seen this, but this is WR140. And there's a star, and this has blown this shell, and then that shell, and that shell, and that shell. And there are 17 shells. 17. No one expected to see anything like that. I think that not in our wildest dreams, the people who are doing these observations, they are thinking, oh, the three or four. That would have been amazing. But this is really regular. It's really every 8 years. You know the distance. You know the velocity, so you can work out the exact 8 years between the spacing between the shells. So this becomes now almost like a precision science, whereas before that it was much more, trying to understand what happens roughly. But now that's pretty amazing data. So I really hope that this is real. It is not some sort of artifact from the telescope. I am still amazed that it is so regular. Right. So, as I said, all these elements are produced in stars. So it's only the first two of the periodic table, hydrogen, helium, and also little bits of lithium, light elements in the Big Bang. But then the carbon in particular, the nitrogen, the oxygen, and all these other elements are made in stars up to around here, and then some of the really rare elements are made in supernovae and in maybe emerging Newton stars and some other exotic places. But the bulk of it, like the carbon from our bones, the oxygen we breathe, is made in these stars. So stars are interesting. And stars also make up galaxies. So we have galaxies like our own Milky Way, which are enriched. Because we have carbon, we have nitrogen, we have oxygen, we have iron. But slightly earlier, we didn't have any of that. They were pristine. Because all that cycle, this dust and gas cycle, the stars and the star forming region hadn't occurred yet. So there was no buildup of metals. Well, that's very different. But we don't really know yet what these galaxies in the early universe look like. Whether they are big galaxies like our own Milky Way, or small galaxies like the large and small magnetic clouds, some of our neighbors. Are very tiny little galaxies. Some of them are a bit more pristine. We can learn about the properties of stars in those galaxies compared to our own. We can learn all kinds of things. But about the early universe, we know still very little. We don't know what caused phase transitions in the universe, in the cosmos. Whether that was small, big galaxies, and so on. So, if you have this cosmic timeline, I mean, I put here first stars and first galaxies, but we really don't know if stars were like the stars in our own Milky Way. Most of the stars in our own Milky Way are solar, like the sun, more or less like the sun. Some of them are very massive. There are very good reasons to assume that these first stars were all very massive. But there are even reasons to assume that these first stars were supermassive, because we now know that there are very large supermassive black holes in the early universe that cannot have formed from mergers. There was not enough time for small galaxies to merge to make large galaxies and large black holes. So people are really seriously talking about supermassive stars, like 100,000 or a million times the mass of the Sun. Now, this is not science fiction, or this is not some crazy practical theory. There are serious scientists who are suggesting these things because people have needed a high redshift. So we need to really understand what are the properties of the stars here. We just don't know. And we don't know what caused this phase transition. Because basically, we had a Big Bang, we had dark ages, because the universe expanded and it got cooler and cooler and cooler. But then suddenly, from ripples that were left over from the Big Bang, and you can see that in the cosmic microwave background. Oh, I thought I had a picture of that. We have stars and galaxies early on. And how do we know that? Well, actually, one of the main things that the Hubble did was people just looked at one of the darkest patches in the sky we could think of, and they just put the Hubble Space Telescope, which is a big telescope, and just expose, just sit on it infinitely, and what they found was this kind of holiday. So you see all these different types of galaxies, big ones, small ones, round ones, not so round, elliptical, all these kind of things. And it turns out, just because something looks big, of course, doesn't mean it is big. It brings me back to Father Ted and the cow in the field, whether it's close up or far away, that has some effect. So some of them, these big ones, might just be big because they are nearby. So how do we know where any of these things are? Whether they're nearby or far away. For that you need the concept of redshift. I hope it now is not correct. Maybe this. There's a delay, and I just don't know where I am. We can do the same with the James Webb Space Telescope. This is a really big cluster, 0723, a galaxy cluster. So stars are often not on their own, but they're often clustered together in galaxies. The same galaxies are often clustered together in galaxy clusters. And if you look at this particular supercluster, what you see is separate, different areas. And you have an image, just like James Webb, but now at these four different points, these four different galaxies, people also took spectra with this NERSPEC instrument on JWST. And what you see is certain emission lines of nebular gases like hydrogen and oxygen. And what you see is that the pattern that you have hydrogen, oxygen, and here another hydrogen line is the same for these galaxies. It's the same pattern. Close to each other and far away, close to each other and then far away there. Basically, what you can do is to realize that these things are shifted. And what we call, this is our own area, our own part of space, a low redshift. And then these things have been shifted to high redshift. Now, how does that work? this works in the same way that sound waves work. If you go outside and listen to a train coming in, you get a frequency coming up, you have a tone that gets shorter and shorter in the frequency, and then when the train leaves again, it's the other way around. The same with light. Light falls onto your eye. If something is moving away from you, it's redshifted. When the frequency goes up, the wavelength is longer. And when it comes to watch you, the wavelength gets shorter. It's called blue shifted. So, that's the Doppler effect. And that holds for any wave, so sound waves or light waves. And in the case of spectra, a spectrum is basically a rainbow. The rainbow is the first spectrum you know in your life. All you need is a lens and an array of light, and you will see that it's dispersed in these colors that I mentioned in the beginning, from purple, ultraviolet, purple, blue, green, all the way to red and infrared. And on top of that, you have certain spectral lines. These are the dark lines. If you have a spectrograph, then these lines will be things like we saw in the previous plot with the hydrogen, the oxygen, and the other hydrogen line. Similarly, a stellar spectrum will have these dark lines superimposed on these rainbows, basically. And if it's just static, if it's just sitting there, it's not moving, nothing is shifted. But if it is moving, then these lines start to move relative to the unshifted positions, where they ought to be if it was not moving. So if it's red shifted, all the lines go that way, and if it's blue shifted, all the lines go that way. So that way, you can really sort out exactly which galaxies are sitting where in velocity, and therefore in distance. So that's very neat, that you can use this to look at any star, right? If you want a planet going around a star, and you want to learn about the masses of the star and the planet, then you can use this kind of technique. But also for galaxies moving away, you can use this technique. And in some cases, nearby galaxies, you could have a situation where one galaxy is moving away from you, the redshifted, and another one is coming towards you, the blue shifted. But when people look at distant galaxies, what they found, if things were normal, if you had a normal universe, then you would have an equal number of blue shifted galaxies and redshifted galaxies. But that was not what they saw, it was not what Hubble saw. What Hubble saw was that all of them were moving away, they were all redshifted, all of them. So there was only one explanation, and that was that our universe expanded. So this was what Hubble plotted. He plotted distances that were determined from cepheids by Henrietta Leavitt 100 years ago, from period luminosity relations. She found these distances on this axis, and then what Hubble did was plotted the velocities from these redshifts on this axis. And then you get a nice relation. Now, this is maybe not the best relation you'll ever see, but it has been improved many times since. This is from the actual discovery paper by Edwin Hubble like 100 years ago. So, by looking at the exact shape of this mathematical relation, you can exactly work out the age of the universe. And that's why we now know the universe is 14 billion years old, because we know the Hubble constant, and we know this relation. So we know we are an expanding universe. And we're pretty certain there's something like a Big Bang. Because if you look at the universe today, it's big. Yesterday, it was smaller. The day before, it was even smaller. If you go backwards in time, you basically come to a point source, like a singularity, like we had in the black hole. And that is basically what I call the Big Bang. And on top of that, there was all kinds of other evidence for the Big Bang, like this nucleosynthesis, where the hydrogen and the helium were produced in this process. We now think that this really was a hot Big Bang. And because of this expanding universe, we can utilize that to our advantage to go back in time. Now, people don't always understand how it works, because we are used to three-dimensional space. I mean, we'd be in the room, we have three dimensions. We have the width of the hole, we have the height, we have the depth. But in reality, it's four dimensions, because there's time as well. Time is like a dimension. If you multiply it by the speed of light, it is like a distance. So there are four of them. So the comparison, think about it like, okay, we go one dimension down. And that is the analogy of the balloon. So in a balloon case, the blowing up of a balloon is basically time. Because you start with no air in the balloon, and then when you blow more and more air in the balloon, you basically increase time. But the surface of the balloon has two dimensions. So it's a bit like this three-dimensional space, but now it doesn't have three dimensions, but only two. Say, only the height and the depth. Now, if you start blowing up, if you are a certain galaxy, say our Milky Way, if you're sitting here, and now you start blowing up the balloon, and you will see that all the other galaxies are moving away from you. So you're sitting here, and this one is moving away from you, this one is moving away. And the reason is because the surface itself, the balloon surface, is moving away. And there's no preferred space. We are not in any way special, just because we see everything moving away from us. Because if you had not been sitting there, but you were a creature, another part of the universe, and you had been sitting over here, then you would have had exactly the same thing. This would be moving away from you. Also, you would have been moving away from this guy. Everything would also move away from them. So basically, it's the space itself that is increasing. And that is the analogy of the expanding universe, where basically it really means that space itself is increasing. So this balloon is there today, yesterday it was a smaller one, tomorrow it will be a bigger one. Now, that is why we can really use these kind of cosmic timelines, that when I talk about time, universe timeline that way, that I can talk about redshift going that way. So time goes from 0 to 14 billion years, redshift goes from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15, maybe 20, we don't know. We don't know when this phase transition to the Dark Ages, to the Renaissance, the first light, when that happened. We don't know. And we don't know what caused it. It could have been massive stars, because these have this ionizing radiation, this ultraviolet radiation. It could also be black holes, supermassive black holes, AGN. These are the two main candidates. And even within those candidates, we don't know if it's massive stars in tiny galaxies, like our neighbors, the large and small magnetic cloud, or big galaxies. What we do know is that bigger galaxies also have bigger black holes. There's a very good relation between the size of a galaxy and the size of a big black hole. So we know certain things, but there's a lot we have no clue about. There we have, that's my background, I lost. So basically, I'm just saying that in that first plot, you saw that, as I said, at 10,000 Kelvin, we have like blue stars, and then at 100 Kelvin, we have red things, and at mid-microwave, here we have just a few Kelvin above absolute zero. So it's minus 270 Celsius, it's plus 3 Kelvin, and you see little fluctuations in this cosmic microwave background. And it's on these tiny fluctuations that the first star in the galaxy is from. So, we now have seen some pictures of this cluster with the James Webb Space Telescope. And I showed you can sort them, the galaxies in a cluster, by redshift, and therefore by distance. But if you look carefully, sometimes, when you look at this one, they have a very funny shape. And then when people look at the spectra, they are exactly the same wavelength. It's not, people think, that's a bit of a coincidence that these are exactly the same distance. So people look at where do these things line up, and then they look at the shape, and what they say, this is not a normal looking galaxy, this is an arc. This is what is called gravitational lensing. And what has happened? The following has happened. If you have a big black hole, maybe I should even go a step back. Let's talk about gravity for a moment. We have two theories for gravity. The first one is Newtonian. So basically, Newton's laws, the phone and the Earth, attract each other. And in fact, whilst it looks looks like my phone is falling towards the Earth, in reality the Earth is also falling towards my phone. It's just not as big an effect. But that is the way we describe it, right? But because the Earth is so much more massive than the phone, to all intents and purposes, we could say the Earth is the potential well. This is basically like a well. Everything flows into the potential well of the Earth. And the same with the black hole. If you have a black hole, stars around it, they can't get out of the influence sphere of this huge black hole, because it's so massive, it's such a high gravity, that nothing can escape. So it's basically the black holes, they kind of ripple space-time around it. This is all due to Einstein, of course. So Einstein came up with this, and he also came up with this gravitational lensing effect. So what does that mean? It doesn't only apply to matter, it doesn't only apply to mobile phones or anything else like stars, but it also applies to light. Light, if you would have a black hole here, and we are sitting over here, and there's something happening over here, like a light thrown with the torch, then the light will not go in a straight line, but the light will be bent around the black hole into our eye. So that's what gravitational lensing is. So here you have something very massive, like a massive cluster. It doesn't really matter what it is, but it is a quasar, or actually a supermassive cluster of galaxies. But if you have something in the back of it, like a distant galaxy, you don't see the distant galaxy once. No, because of the lens, it really is like a magnifying glass. If you look in here, and the image of that distant galaxy is projected twice. It's projected here, and it is projected there. So we see it twice. And that's very suspicious. You see something that is actually the same thing, you see it twice. So you can be really fooled if you don't realize this effect. Then you might think we have two identical galaxies, but we don't. So this looks like a bit of a nuisance, that this thing gets in the middle and then distorts our view. But on the other hand, it's a gift, because it can magnify things by factors of thousands of times. So things that are should not be visible yet, because they are too early in the universe, they happened too long ago, our telescopes are not big enough, like the Hubble Space Telescope, should not be big enough. But it is. We can actually see things at redshifts, at distances, that we otherwise, without this magnification, never see. And this has been really exciting over the last couple of years in particular. And now the James Webb is going to explode, because the telescope is much bigger, and this effect is going to be really crucial and really key to understanding the very, very first galaxies. So this is opening Pandora's box. This is Able 2744, Pandora cluster. And you can see just with both James Webb and with the Hubble Space Telescope, all kinds of interesting phenomena, where you can really start to use huge galaxy clusters. And in the background, you have these tiny galaxies that can really tell you something about the very first stars. First galaxies in particular. But the galaxies, so you think, are made of stars. But a galaxy, like our own galaxy, is like hundreds of billions of stars. Now, something that I think is really exciting is the next one. This is the sunrise arc. This is Hubble. I should say Hubble Space Telescope, but it's now also been observed in James Webb. And this is the sunrise arc. It's a galaxy. It's been sort of this arc. And here's a cluster. And here's a cluster. And the tiny thing. This is just a globe of what's happening here. But the tiny little dot there. What kind of galaxy is that? It's not a galaxy at all. It's a star. An individual star. And a redshift 6. It's a blue supergiant that has been gravitationally lensed by a big galaxy cluster, and because of the huge magnification, by fact 1,000, we can now see individual stars in the early universe. This star is called Arendelle, morning star, and I think this really blows my mind. That we can now, because I've always written in grant proposals with James Webb Space Telescope, which we thought was going to fly 10 years ago, 5 years ago, I always said, we need to understand the light from these galaxies, and it's made up from all these stars. We need to integrate the light from all these massive stars together, and then we can predict what we see with James Webb. Because we can never see individual stars in the early universe. Well, I was wrong. It's there. Just because of the gravitational lensing effect, you can actually, you might find hard to see it. You need a lensing model, and there are details that even to me are quite obscure, but it really is claimed to be a star. And I've seen James Webb data of this, and it really is a star. Yeah. Now, it's somewhere, it's very uncertain yet, because it's just with photometry, but the spectrum is going to be taken as we speak. And from the photometry, it looks like it's between 50 and 100 times the mass of the sun. But with the spectrum, it should be possible to really pinpoint the exact properties of the star. So we can really know whether these kind of massive stars that we see nearby are the same in the universe. And then, of course, you need to find more of these. And then you can also look at superluminous supernovae that occur at higher magnitudes. And to really start to form a picture of stellar evolution, not in our own way, but in the early universe. So to really start to see which stars are blue, yeah, which stars are expanded, because some of these massive stars might expand, like red superchance, but probably all of them don't. And it makes a big difference, because if the star is blue, it is very hot, it has all this ionizing radiation, and it can re-ionize the universe. But if it's not, if it's red, then yeah, you can see that nicely in infrared, but it has no ionizing photons. It will be useless for ionizing radiation. You will never have re-ionize the universe. And in that case, it has to be that the re-ionization comes from these supermassive black holes. But then the question is, where do they come from? Do they come from mergers, or do they come from supermassive stars? So there's still lots and lots of open questions, but it is important to know that I think it's these kind of observations and this kind of modeling of this kind of star that will really start to build up the history of the universe, which is a chemical enrichment, from the beginning to where we are now. Because up to now, they've just been basically, we've missed the beginning. We only have the outcome. What were the conditions that were necessary to create life? Like us here in the room. But there's a whole history ahead of it. And all the models we've built over the last 50 years or so, they might all be wrong. If these first stars turn out to be very different, that would be a huge consequence, because everything that's built on it, any error that we made about our assumptions that happened here, the whole part of our house of cards would be crumbling down. So I look forward to that. And next time I'll tell you a bit more about that.
Jorick, yeah. That's fantastic. It's really brilliant to get an insight into the science behind these beautiful pictures, fantastic pictures. Jorick, just looking back.